everyone. My name is Valerie and I am the Outreach Coordinator for Future Energy Systems. Welcome back to part 3 of Ivy and Bean's What's the Big Idea? Written by Annie Barrows and illustrated by Sophie Blackall. Scientific Principles. Welcome to the Emerson School Science Fair, said a big sign over the cafeteria door. There was the principal standing by the door saying hello to parents. She was smiling, but Bean thought you could never be too careful about principals. I know a shortcut, she said to her mom and dad. Let's go through the kitchen. Once they were inside, Bean and her parents met up with Ivy and her mom. Where's your project, girls? Asked Ivy's mom. Our class is over here, said Bean quickly. Let's go. Sure enough, there was Miss Aruba Tate next to a table marked Room 12, Global Warming. Before her parents could start yakking with Miss Aruba Tate, Bean dragged them over to a bench where 5 kids were sitting in a row. Look, she pointed. That's Vanessa's project. Her mom and dad looked. Looks like a pack of kids to me, her dad said. What's the project? Wait, you'll see, said Bean. 5, yelled Vanessa, holding a small clock. 4, 3. I have to go to the bathroom, said one of the kids. No, you don't. 2, 1, go. Altogether, the 5 kids took a deep breath and held it in. These are my brothers and sisters, Vanessa explained to the watching parents. We're reducing carbon dioxide by not breathing out. Toby can hold his breath for 76 seconds. If everyone stopped breathing out for 15 minutes a day, the world would be a lot cooler. She looked at her clock again. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Whew! The kids blew out their held up breaths. Their faces were red. Are you guys doing yours soon? Vanessa called to Ivy. Ivy made a shh face and turned to her mom. Come on, Mom. I want to show you McAdam's lime car. McAdam was hiding under the table, but he had a real lime with a paperclip and a penny in it, and his drawing on the top of the table. It smelled good. Next door was Eric's project. He hadn't had time to build the garbage robot, so he used one of his toy robots to show his idea. A little plastic man had just tossed a clump of paper on the ground. He was smiling. He had no idea that behind him a robot was glaring, waiting to whack him on the head. Eric had made a poster. It read, "Clean up or else." Next to Eric's robot was a vacuum cleaner. Dustit's idea was to vacuum up all the heat, put it in a giant bag, and send it into outer space. In real life, it would have to be a special vacuum cleaner. But he had brought in a regular one as an example. So that's where it went, his mom said. Margalie had made a picture of Earth with mirrors sticking up all over it. She said that the mirrors would reflect the sun's rays back into outer space. Wow, said Bean's dad, looking at her picture. Pretty good idea. Bean almost said, wait till you see ours, but she didn't. She looked at Ivy and made a mouth-zipping sign. Ivy nodded. Drew had made a baking soda and vinegar volcano. It didn't have much to do with global warming, but it was fun to watch the foam spurt out of the top. He had put green food coloring in the vinegar. Emma and Zuzu had taken about 200 pictures of themselves digging holes and planting trees. There was also a picture of Rose the yard duty yelling at them for digging holes in the school lawn. Underneath, Emma had written, "Doesn't care about global warming." But Ivy, said Ivy's mom, where's your project? Ivy gave Bean a help me look, but then, just in the nick of time, Miss Aruba Tate interrupted. Excuse me, may I borrow your daughter? She asked. It's almost time, she said to Ivy and Bean. We have to go do our project, explained Bean to her parents. But what is it? Asked her mom. It's a secret, said Miss Aruba Tate. You're going to find out in a few minutes. Right, girls? Right, they agreed. Grown-ups don't usually do what kids tell them to do, so Bean and Ivy had asked Miss Aruba Tate to give the orders. Miss Aruba Tate spoke into a microphone. All available parents, please come to the back of the cafeteria. Come to the back of the cafeteria. She had to say it 12 times before the parents obeyed. And they get mad at us if they have to say things twice, whispered Bean to Ivy. Finally, a group of grown-ups was clustered at the back of the cafeteria. Okay, said Miss Aruba Tate. This is Bean, she pointed to Bean, and this is Ivy, she pointed to Ivy. Follow them. The other teachers and I will stay with the kids. Is this your project? Asked Bean's dad. Yes, said Bean. Come on, follow us. Where are we going? Asked someone's mom. Just outside, said Ivy. Not far. Come on. How long's this gonna take? Asked another mom. Not long. Don't worry, said Bean. With grown-ups crowded behind them, they walked across the cafeteria and out the door into the cool night air. The grown-ups were mumbling things like, what's going on, and it's late, and sorry, when they bumped into each other. But since the teacher had told them to, they followed Ivy and Bean across the playground to the lawn. The light from the cafeteria was very dim. You could just barely see that the lawn was covered in rugs and blankets. Ivy and Bean stopped, and the grown-ups bunched up around them. Here's what's going to happen, said Bean. There's a blanket, or a rug, or yoga mat for each of you. We'll take you out with our flashlights and show you a good spot. Then you just lie down. And then what? Asked Ivy's mom. She sounded worried. And then you rest, said Ivy. Don't be nervous, she added to her mom. I'll be right here. What does this have to do with global warming? Asked Dustit's mom. Ivy smiled mysteriously, but no one could see her in the dark. Just try it, she said. Ivy and Bean showed all the grown-ups where to lie down. It was lucky that Miss Aruba Tate had brought extra towels, because there were more grown-ups than they had planned for. Even the principal wanted to lie down. Bean gave her an entire blanket to herself. Soon, there were grown-ups scattered all across the grass. In the dark, they looked like laundry. Now, said Bean in a loud voice, look into the sky. Smell how nice the grass is. Listen to the trees. And just rest. Don't talk. Don't do anything. And don't worry. You're totally safe. Happy endings. A few grown-ups muttered. Bean heard someone say something about bedtime. One dad sat up, but he flopped down again when he saw Bean coming towards him. In a minute or two, the grown-ups got quiet. Ivy and Bean heard some gentle sighs. Ivy poked Bean in the ribs. See, she whispered. They're getting happy. Bean was getting happy, too. She couldn't lie down because she was taking care of the grown-ups, but she could feel the cool night air, and she could listen to the leaves move. She could smell the damp dirt under the grass. Ivy stood side by side, making sure nothing surprising happened. I think they're liking nature, whispered Ivy. I think so too, whispered Bean. For just a moment, she felt like the grown-ups were little ants, and she was the giant who understood how big the world really was. A grown-up began to snore softly. Way out on the lawn, the principal curled up on her side. Ivy checked Miss Aruba Tate's glow-in-the-dark watch. 2 more minutes, she whispered. Ivy and Bean watched the grown-ups resting. The 2 minutes passed. All right, grown-ups, said Ivy gently. It's time to get up now. Some of the grown-ups moaned a little bit. They didn't want to get up. Eventually, they struggled to their feet, except for the 3 who'd fallen asleep. Bean woke them nicely. It would have been fun to pour water on them, but that wouldn't have made them happy. When all of them were on their feet again, Bean said, okay, that was our science project. You can go now. But they didn't. They stood looking at her and Ivy. Wait, said a mom. How was that about global warming? Ivy and Bean glanced at each other. Even in the dim light, Bean could see that the grown-ups were confused. Were you happy? Asked Bean. What? Said the mom. Were you happy while you were lying down? Asked Bean. Well, yes, said the mom. Sure, it was great. That's it, said Ivy. We wanted you all to feel happy in nature. So you would care about global warming, explained Bean. There was a little pause. Bean and Ivy looked at each other. What was so hard to understand? And then the mom said, oh, I get it. The other grown-up smiled. That's a good one, said a dad. That's a really good one. The other grown-ups yawned and nodded. They began to drift back to the cafeteria, except for Ivy and Bean's parents. Ivy's mom took Ivy's hand. I was happy, she said. Really? You weren't worried about poison oak or bugs? Ivy asked. At first, I was a little bit. But then I did what you said. I listened to the trees and I smelled the grass. I haven't done that in a long time. And now you care about global warming? Ivy asked. Sure I do. Ivy turned to Bean. It worked. being elbowed Ivy. Of course it worked. It couldn't help working. It's science. As they walked back towards the cafeteria to give Miss Aruba Tate her watch, Bean's dad put his arm around her shoulders. That was a great science project, sweetie. Much better than my poster idea. Bean gave him a squeeze. Oh, Dad, don't feel bad. You're a grown-up. You can't help it. Ivy and Bean let the grown-ups walk ahead. They're all caring about global warming now, said Ivy. I can tell. We should give classes, said Bean. It would be nice if we could have found one big solution to global warming, said Ivy. Yeah, said Bean. But we had lots of good small ideas. And we're only beginners, said Ivy. If the two of us work on global warming for 10 more years, I bet we find the solution. Once again, Bean pictured herself holding up a test tube full of shimmery pink stuff while white-coated scientists gasped in amazement. The first thing we need to do, said Bean, is get our hands on a really dangerous chemistry set. The end. And at the end, we also have some answers to questions. So why can't we just throw ice cubes in the air and other ideas about global warming? What is global warming anyway? Everyone likes to be cozy and warm, but too warm is bad. Too warm is sweaty and gross. You all know that people and cars and factories have put a lot of pollution in the air. There's a thick layer of pollution way up in the sky. It isn't so thick that the sun's warmth can't get down to the earth, but it's so thick that the heat can't bounce off the earth and return to outer space where it started. That's what's supposed to happen, but it can't. The heat is trapped down here in our atmosphere, otherwise known as the sky surrounding our planet. Because of this, the planet is getting hotter and hotter. People may not notice it when they're walking around, going to school, playing soccer, and eating breakfast, but it's happening. You would really notice it if you were in the North Pole, where the ice is melting, which is bad news for creatures that live on ice like polar bears. You would notice it if you were a frog who wanted to live in a stream that had dried up, or a bird who wanted to build a nest in a redwood tree that couldn't grow without plenty of nice cold fog. Global warming is bad for animals and plants, for sure. It's also bad for us, because, really, who wants to live in a world without frogs? Not me. And even if you think you could manage to live without frogs, you have to think about what frogs do. Among other things, they eat mosquitoes. So, no frogs equals many more mosquitoes. Scratch, scratch, scratch. And that's just one example. So how can this problem be fixed? Some people are trying to figure out ways to let the heat out of our atmosphere. Some are trying to clean up pollution that's floating around up there. Some are trying to make cars and factories that pollute less in the first place. It's hard, though. It's hard because almost every solution involves people giving something up. Take recycling, for instance. Recycling is good for the earth because if you can reuse stuff, it doesn't have to be made all over again, which means less factory pollution. Cool. But recycling also means you have to get up off your duff and find the right recycling bin, and sometimes you have to pick your disgusting old hot dog wrapper out of the garbage can and put it in the recycling bin. Still, in comparison to no polar bears or frogs, it doesn't seem like much to complain about. But recycling is just one tiny example of a solution. What are some of the others? Let's take a look at some of the ideas Miss Aruba Tate's students have. Why can't we just throw ice cubes in the air? As much as I hate to admit it, Nancy was right about this one. The sun is stronger than all the ice cubes we could make on Earth, and the energy it takes to make all those ice cubes causes pollution. Darn. Why can't we plant a whole bunch of trees that will eat up all the pollution? We can and we are. Areas where trees got chopped down 100 years ago are being replanted with new trees. The problem is that we can't plant enough trees to eat all the pollution because we don't have enough space. Why can't everyone stop breathing so much? It's true that people breathe out carbon dioxide, which is one of the gases holding heat in our atmosphere. But breathing makes so little carbon dioxide compared to, say, driving a car, that holding your breath wouldn't make much difference. And it's probably not good for you either. Why can't cars run on limes instead of gasoline? They can, but it would take so many limes that we'd have to rip out all the trees we've got and replace them with lime trees in order to get enough fuel for just a couple hundred cars. What we need is clean energy, which means fuel that doesn't pollute and is easy to find or make. There's gotta be a great clean energy out there somewhere. It's probably something that's lying around all over the place, something no one has realized could be used for fuel. What could it be? Earwax? Why can't we get energy by breaking stuff into bits? We can. It's called nuclear fission, and the person who thought of it was Lise Meitner. Ivy calls her Lisa something. The stuff you break has to be tinier than rice, though. You have to break the center of atoms, which are almost the tiniest things on the planet, but very strong. When you pull them apart, they release a whole lot of energy. This is great, because energy is what we need, except that breaking them apart requires an enormous machine that's really expensive. Also, it causes a lot of another kind of pollution that is dangerous to plants and animals. Why can't we vacuum up all the heat and send it out into space? Scientists are working to make artificial trees that suck carbon dioxide out of the air, which is kind of like a vacuum cleaner. A real vacuum cleaner type machine wouldn't work because the heat is inside the earth and the oceans. And how is a vacuum cleaner going to slurp heat out of an ocean? Also, because rockets use lots of fuel, the amount of heat caused by sending the vacuum cleaner bag into space would add back all the heat you just subtracted. Why can't we put up mirrors to reflect the sun's rays back before they get trapped under our pollution? It's a good idea, and scientists are working on it. Some scientists are thinking about putting giant mirrors in the desert, but that would be really expensive because the mirrors would have to be enormous. Some are thinking about putting a bunch of tiny mirrors in outer space, but there's that blasting off problem again. So what can we do about it? There's probably not one thing that will fix global warming, unless I'm right about earwax. But if everyone works at it to the best of their ability, we might be able to have a world we all want to live in. And that's the end of Ivy and Bean, What's the Big Idea? Do you guys have any ideas that could be used to fight global warming? Maybe you need to go lie down in nature and see what you can come up with. At Future Energy Systems, our researchers are looking for all the different solutions that they can think of. So check out more of our Future Energy Systems videos, and make sure you check out the activities below to learn some more. Bye! Thank you so much for watching Future Energy Systems video. Make sure to subscribe so you don't miss any of our exciting content. Check out the links below to our website and learning page where you can find activities, learning extension, and more. You can also sign up on the website for notifications for future videos and interactive opportunities. There's so much to learn as we explore our energy future.